Cell phones, vaccines, space travel. All of these technologies exist because scientists work together to make it happen. But all great minds have to start somewhere. I'm Nathalie Pozo. Follow us today as we walk you through stories from across the nation that showcase the importance of an education in STEM. That's science, technology, engineering, and math, all fields that make our lives better and better connected. Starting things off, we're heading to Kentucky, where WLKY reporter Carrie Grace sees how some volunteers are demystifying the world of coding.
The world of coding and programming can seem difficult to most people, but Hour of Code is about teaching kids they can do it too.
Who enjoys maybe one of these?
First graders at Goshen Elementary School are diving into computer science with a little guidance from UPS programmers.
Most of the kids like those apps on those phones and those computers, and when you translate that to language and coding, they really start to get involved with it.
UPS programmers are volunteering in all 16 Oldham County schools for Hour of Code Week.
The 500,000 jobs in the U.S. for coding or computer science specifically is we have about 50,000 graduates as of 2016 from our universities and colleges across the U.S. So you can see there's a great need.
White says not only is there a shortage of qualified graduates in the industry, but there's a shortage of females and minorities. The hope is that by showing kids how computer science works at an early age, it will spark an interest and they'll continue down that path.
We're constantly moving into the next technology age. I mean, UPS just introduced drones. You know, we want, you know, the market to grow, the industry to grow, so we can have more kids doing the programming for us and continue to grow our market, be innovative.
Good luck to all of those kids. Next up, we hear from one Louisiana engineer who is inspiring others with her incredible journey. Here's WDSU's Randy Russo with the story.
Since she was a small girl, Dr. Renee Horton always wanted to shoot for the stars.
I got a telescope when I was 9 from my dad, and it really just opened up my eyes that there's so much more to the world than just us and the place that we stand, you know.
She dreamed of being an astronaut, but learned as a teen she had a hearing disability. However, the idea of space continued to pull her in. So as a single mother of three, she enrolled in LSU's electrical engineering program 10 years later.
So going back to school with the three kids was amazing, though. In that, because it was hard, it was tough, but it gave us all that growing feeling that how important education was.
And in 2011, she became the first African American to graduate with a PhD in material sciences with a concentration in physics from the University of Alabama. So now, in addition to working as the lead engineer on NASA's Artemis program at Mishu, sending the first woman and the next man to the moon, Dr. Horton has a greater mission, promoting STEM studies for children across Louisiana.
Math is the foundation for those kids, because if they can't really understand how to think in an abstract form, right? Math, numbers, that whole thing is kind of an abstract form of a language.
She's a mentor in the Chevron Fueling Math program, launching lessons virtually and in person for hundreds of our kids, connecting our culture with calculations.
Cooking is the biggest math problem there is, right? So take a recipe and say, the recipe says it's for 4 people, but now we only want to do it for 2 people. So can you help me calculate half of this recipe?
And she's seeing that interest take flight.
When we talk about excitement, when you have 200 kids show up on a Saturday morning, you tell me whether or not that's a gauge for an excitement.
It truly is so inspiring to see her taking her talent and passing it along to the next generation. All right, now we're headed to Oklahoma City, where one young man is using STEM to give back despite a terrible accident. Jessica Shambach from KOCO has the story.
basketball was definitely a really big part of my life. It's really what I wanted to do.
Oklahoma City's Aiden Spencer thought basketball was life until he couldn't play. Not long after his family home burned down in 2014, Aiden broke his back in a car crash with a distracted driver. His mom was left in a wheelchair.
It was a pretty traumatic experience that basically left me feeling helpless.
Aiden's doctor told him it would be years before he could play sports again.
I was really depressed and I didn't have a lot to do of anything.
During his recovery, two friends invited him to a robotics club. One meeting, and his love for STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math, was born.
I immediately knew like this would be the place for me. It gave me a purpose and something that I could work towards.
Aiden wanted other athletes and students to find a passion for STEM too. So he put in the work raising money and accessibility. He started three robotics teams here locally.
I was lucky enough to start like cold calling businesses and stuff like that, and I was able to make some partnerships with like Bank First and Sonic.
The 18-year-old's efforts landed him national attention. Aiden just won a 4-H Youth in Action Award and scholarship via HughesNet, and he was picked to take part in a trivia challenge with Bill Nye, the Science Guy.
Changing the world one student at a time.
Right on!
Coming up, a young girl takes coding into her own hands after the break. Welcome back. Now we're headed to Baltimore, where WBAL reporter Brianna Ross talks to a young girl who is taking her STEM education into her own hands.
From a young age, Grace Brem has had a knack for technology and computer science.
I think it was mostly like my dad being an engineer, and he was always like talking to us about like circuits, and I was always like wondering how things work.
Brem took that interest with her to high school, joined the cybersecurity club at the all-girls Notre Dame Preparatory School her freshman and sophomore year, but she was disappointed in the turnout.
Even though there are like 600 students that can join the club, only about 10 or 15 students are actually in the club.
Just down the road at the all-boys Loyola Blakefield, Brem says the cybersecurity club is one of the school's biggest activities.
It has more than 100 students involved in the club.
So junior year, Brem joined Loyola Blakefield's club, became the only girl on the team. She made it her mission to find out why more girls weren't interested in computer science.
There just aren't a lot of resources that are aimed towards women. Like textbooks usually use more stereotypically male colors, and there's just not a lot of female role models in the field, which is really unfortunate.
So Brem set out to change that. The teen wrote and published this book, An Introduction to Computer Science for Young People, sharing some basics about the field.
On the cover of the book, I chose colors that are both stereotypically male and female. I also chose to include the stories of some really important female leaders. It's definitely going to inspire a lot of people and hopefully girls to join the field, and hopefully they'll see me and think that they can do something.
Letting girls of all ages know the computer science field can be for them too.
What a great lesson in determination and drive. Ever wonder if math could make your shots better in basketball? These kids in Milwaukee are about to find out. Here's WISN's Gabriella Garza.
Practice makes perfect. Athletes have heard it time and time again.
I just want to learn how to become a better athlete and see like how math and science can help me become better.
But a new partnership is helping kids bridge the gap between sports and science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, or STEM.
About 12 years ago, we really started focusing on how can we get kids who are not big fans of math and science engaged in the STEM principles in an environment that felt natural to them.
And their station set up all around the court here in the gym. It's showing them how to connect STEM and basketball. This setup right here, showing them how to increase their shooting average.
STEM not only helping these Racine and Milwaukee students improve their game.
Analytics have become extremely important. So the understanding, even as a young person, of how that works is really important. And then there's a lot of jobs in sports that involve analytics that you can do when you get to the point where the ball stops bouncing.
Racine and Milwaukee are very indicative of, you know, a lot of other cities around the country in terms of how women and black and brown students are widely underrepresented in the STEM fields.
This clinic setting students up for a future on the court or off it.
The earlier you engage them and the earlier you expose them, the sky is truly the limit.
That's so cool, taking education from the classroom to the court. Now we head to DC to see a very large collection of orange statues. Here's reporter Aixa Diaz.
120 statues.
It's very empowering.
Life-sized, 3D printed, and orange.
I think they're really encouraging.
Stand throughout the Smithsonian buildings along the National Mall.
I think we really hit a nerve.
The statues depict engineers, doctors, entrepreneurs, scientists, all modern women in science, tech, engineering, and math, known as STEM.
People who are doing really amazing work right now, who could be the next generation, who are inspiring the next generation, that's where the real opportunity is.
Great.
The exhibit, installed on Women's History Month, focuses on the future instead of the past.
If you can see it, then you can be it. That's really the motto.
The Smithsonian calls this the largest collection of women statues ever assembled.
Who are doing really interesting things.
Dr. Corey Lathan is one of the 120 women represented.
I'm going to try and stimulate the vagus nerve through the ear.
Dr. Lathan works to improve human performance through tech innovations.
She is a scientist and an entrepreneur and an inventor, and she spans the world of health and science and tech.
With women filling just 25% of STEM positions, Dr. Lathan hopes these statues will inspire girls to one day fill her shoes.
I believe if you show young women the power of technology, then they will create a bright future.
It doesn't matter what you look like, where you come from, what your background is, how old you are, you can do amazing things.
Coming up after the break, we hear how young people are putting STEM skills to good use. We'll be right back. Thanks for staying with us. Keeping track of sports stats can be pretty time-consuming, which is why some University of Nebraska students used their computer science skills to come up with an answer. Quanicia Frazier at KETV has the story.
Hitting, pitching, fielding.
As the manager of the University of Nebraska Lincoln baseball team, Daniel Stara has to keep up with a lot.
It was our job as managers after practice to aggregate all that data, put it into Excel.
The computer science major wanted to find an easier way to organize all that information, so he thought, why not come up with an app?
At night, 9 p.m. to 1 a.m., most of the nights I would learn JavaScript and all that different stuff that goes into making an app.
In 2019, Stara teamed up with his college roommate and fellow UNL student Parker Hill to create TAP.
You can track anything that you want to that's most important to your team and the development of your players.
It's an app that coaches, players, and managers can use to keep track of all sorts of baseball stats.
If your infielders are making good throws and they're making good fielding plays, if they're diving during practice, showing competitiveness and being aware during practice.
TAP was eventually selected by UNL's Rake School of Computer Science and Management to be the design studio sponsor.
So they provide us with office space, computers that we need, mentors that we need.
Miller and Stara work with two other students to keep the app running, all while getting course credits.
Made a lot of mistakes, but every day in practice we'd test it out and use it, and then that night we would make changes and make it better for the next day.
Necessity is the mother of invention, and so is a little competition. Next, we turn to a Kentucky high school robotics team that hopes their creation has what it takes to win gold. WLKY reporter Addie Miners has more.
I'm here at the Makerspace at Central High School, where students in the cyber engineering program are gearing up their new robot for competition.
Right now we have our intake, which, you know, brings in the ball, and we have our flywheels, which shoot it out.
The object of the competition, to shoot as many balls into the basket as possible in 2.5 minutes.
We also have a climbing period, last 30 seconds for the match. We can climb up to the second rung, which will give us 6 points.
The class built the robot as part of the engineering program at Central. Students interested in STEM can use the program to prepare for the future.
What we found is it's kind of irresponsible for us not to teach this kind of stuff.
before we started the robotics program, we were working on a computer repair. Well, there's not a lot of repairing to computers anymore, especially something like a Chromebook. So we want them to learn computer programming, and we tricked them into learning computer programming by making something physical that can run.
I'm personally becoming a mechanical engineer, so this is definitely a big leap forward. And I think it'll just the experience itself will help me in college and past college.
It's also helped me to sort of understand where before I was just doing computer programming, how to make computer programming work with like physical robots and things like that.
Although Sam and Aiden have interests in different fields of engineering, this competition has them working together along with their teammates to build a winning bot. Something Aiden says they think they have accomplished.
Our robot does the task, I think it does it well, so I think we can probably get fairly high in the qualifications and go into alliance round.
It's amazing if you give students the parts and you give them the facilities and you give them the pieces, there's almost nothing they cannot do.
Now here's a group of techie do-gooders in Iowa who are putting their coding skills to use. Here's Kayla James from KCCI in Des Moines.
What looks like a series of numbers and letters to some people,
because you have to do default props, dot center, dot
LNG.
LNG.
Is a language programmers know too well, especially this group of high school and college students.
In elementary school, we did this thing called Hour of Code, and so that's, I guess, kind of the first place I got interested in programming.
Connor Fogarty, the junior at Valley High School, a whiz on the computer, and the president of Devs Do Good. It's a nonprofit that, through a grant provided by Microsoft, brought tables surrounded by smart young minds together for a hackathon.
We kind of build out websites or tools for the nonprofits here.
Let's say that you had...
With mentors on hand.
You'll need the A tag around the entry field.
And teams talking through their plans, the group worked diligently throughout the day for nonprofit leaders.
I can make a Word document, and that's about it.
Like Lisa Waters and Christine Conway of Thrive Academy, who are in need of help.
And our mission is to create opportunities for young adults with intellectual disabilities.
Conway and Waters are both mothers of children with intellectual disabilities who have aged out of the school system. They're passionate about their nonprofit. They just needed help with their online presence.
So they don't have a website currently, so that's what we're doing here today for them.
Whether it was building a website or an app, Saturday's team did it all in 10 hours. More than just real-world experience and new connections, they left a lasting impact on everyone in the room.
These kids are the future, and we're in really good hands.
Our next story is about some lucky Massachusetts students who got a very long-distance Zoom call. WCVB reporter Doug Meehan learned more.
This is Alpha Bravo 1 Oscar Charlie for a scheduled school contact. Over.
Alpha Bravo 1 Oscar Charlie, this is November Alpha 1 Sierra Sierra. Have you loud and clear?
It was an out-of-this-world experience for these students from Bishop Gurton High School in Nashua. They made contact with the International Space Station.
It truly was a once-in-a-lifetime experience.
All members of the school's STEM club, it was a chance for them to chat directly with astronaut Shannon Walker on board the ISS.
It was really quite something to be able to speak to an astronaut that far away up in space.
This opportunity was anything but your normal Zoom call. The kids were in New Hampshire, while Walker was traveling at 1,700 miles an hour, some 250 miles above them.
It was pretty interesting because, you know, we were given a very specific time, days in advance, so we had to make sure that we were ready at that exact second for when they came over the horizon.
Teaming up with the Nashua Area Radio Society, the students making the connection via amateur radio.
And what landmark on Earth looks the most amazing from space? Over.
You know what? I think the Grand Canyon looks most amazing from space.
The interaction, eye-opening for the students in how science is truly a team effort.
It was nice to see that they have a collaborative atmosphere that even the astronauts have to depend on the people on the ground, and they all have to work together.
I was so excited that this hard work finally showed itself.
Science teacher Karen Krivick says, although the focus of the event was to highlight the possibilities of amateur radio, it was also an opportunity for students to learn that their future is only limited by their own imagination.
And anything is possible, really. You put your mind to it and you can do it.
Astronaut Shannon Walker is currently serving as flight engineer as part of NASA's Expedition 64 team. It's her second long-duration stint on the space station. And as the students found out, becoming an astronaut is what she wanted to do since she was 4 years old.
What a way to inspire the next generation. Now for our final story from WESH's Scott Heidler on the Space Coast. Students at a Florida elementary school are being prepped for a lifetime in the sciences.
They start them young here in Brevard.
I would like to be an astronaut. My mom also works at NASA to build rockets.
There you go.
These kindergartens go to South Lake Elementary School in Titusville, just 17 miles from the Kennedy Space Center. Great location now, but when the space shuttle program shut down 12 years ago, the school also shut, lack of funding. It reemerged in parallel with the commercial spaceflight industry 4 years ago. The school reopened with new focus, educating the next generation of space industry talent.
There are so many different types of careers at Kennedy Space Center, at Lockheed Martin. They're not just hiring rocket scientists, they're hiring managers who can effectively communicate with one another. They are hiring electricians. They are hiring people who know a trade.
While yes, some students are looking forward to blasting off, some see other ways to work in space. A curiosity sparked from the experiments and exposure at South Lake. Even the daughter of someone who does work on rockets.
Yeah, he does get kind of jealous with some of the things that we do, because he's like, oh, that sounds really fun. I wish I had that at my school.
And this is a man who now works for Blue Origin and used to work for SpaceX.
Yes.
That's pretty cool.
South Lake teachers describe this as the beginning of the talent pipeline of bright minds they hope will stay in Brevard County, or at least launch from it.
Well, I hope these stories have left you inspired to reach for the stars. I'm Nathalie Pozo. From all of us here at Stitch, thank you for watching. We'll see you next time.